And on behalf of the National HRD Network Mumbai Chapter, extend a very warm welcome to each one of you. The National HRD Network, or NHRDN, established in 1986, currently spread across 30 chapters in India, is the national apex body of professionals committed towards development of human resource professionals through education, training, research, and experience sharing. The NHRD Mumbai chapter has also been striving to offer this very core NHRD value proposition through various initiatives and events across relevant themes. Today, the NHRD Mumbai chapter presents to you an evening seminar on impacting business success through HR mastery. May I now call up on stage Mr. Jugajit Das, Chief Human Resources, ICICI Prudential Life Insurance Company Limited, and President, NHRDN Mumbai Chapter, to share his thoughts on NHRDN and the Mumbai Chapter initiatives, as well as to introduce today's topic and our very distinguished speaker and facilitator for today evening, Mr. Chubro Mitra. Over to you.
So, just want to take some time to introduce Chubro Mitra and talk about him. And you know, we are deeply grateful that you could make time out to be with us this evening. And it's a big privilege for me personally, and I'm sure it will be for all of us today. I've now known Chubro for more than 16 years because he was my former boss when I joined ICICI Prudential Life. So of course, I've known him fairly intimately, I can say. And it is indeed a privilege for me to also introduce him. So while his background is there for all of you to see, but I thought it's going to be more relevant to talk about him as a person. So I was reminiscing, in fact, of the time I've known him. I remember the first day I met him also at work. And but I think from an HR professional's perspective, there are two, if I were to say, traits, or if you were to talk about two words, you know, when people ask you the question, what are the two things that come to your mind when you think of somebody? So for me, Chubro exemplifies courage and humility. And I'll explain why. Okay? And why that's so relevant for an HR profession, right? Courage because I've seen Chubro deal with enormous personal and professional challenges and emerged out of it stronger each time. And I think in all our careers, in all our life, and since we're talking about HR mastery, if any of us want to be a professional, there are ups and downs in life, the many challenges that we overcome or need to overcome. And meeting that with courage is something that many of us falter. Many of us falter. I've seen so many cases of careers not going where they are because somewhere people could not summon the courage to deal with adversity. But I think in a career which has spanned over, what, 34, 5 years now? 32 years, you know, you have to be a marathoner who can run that far, right? And there are many people, of course, there are many people, but very few actually manage to make it happen. A lot of people, increasingly we find, a lot of people are having to, you know, take the route out. So it is a challenge to pace yourself and to make sure that you can run the course. Because if you can run the course, success will be yours, right? And the other thing, which is the point about humility, I want to talk about. Humility, at one level, the way that I can define it, is not about being humble. That's one part of it. But humility is really about willingness to learn and adapt. So if you look at Chubro's career here, he started with Oberoi Group in the travel division, moved to ICI, which is a blue chip multinational in human resources, one of the foremost companies for human resources practices in that era, and worked with Cadbury's, worked with ICICI Prudential Life, and now with AXA for the last almost 10 years. It requires a lot of reinvention, right, to be able to move from different cultures, right? It might sound simple to say that, okay, I work for a multinational corporation and I moved to an Indian organization. I think Balapur would have been a big transition in terms of culture, right? And similarly, a Cadbury's or a professional startup like a ICICI Prudential, right? A startup and from moving on to a startup to a multinational organization in a complete labor, if somebody were to tell me at my age to move to a multinational, I don't know whether I'll be able to adjust them. Because a lot of things is about how do you adapt and how do you change and how do you learn and make a part of your whole DNA. So in my word, while I've used courage and humility, what I'm really emphasizing is the word reinvention. because the only thing that we know that is happening around us is the world is changing all the time, right? And especially for all of you young professionals and students, the only thing we can know with certainty is that the world today will be different from the world tomorrow, right? And the only way to cope with the uncertain world, there's a word called VUCA that we talk about, volatile, ambiguous, complex and uncertain, is that the only way you can cope with all this uncertainty, with all the changes, that you keep on reinventing yourself. You are lean, you're agile, you're flexible, and yes, the humility to learn and adapt, and the courage to face the equanimity, all the challenges that life throws at you, right? So we have a wealth of experience in Shubhro, a wealth of experience that you can learn from. So I'm sure he's going to make it interactive, he's going to talk a lot about from his personal experience. I've requested him to do that. And of course, we have my colleague Anuj, who's going to be putting some questions to him. But it is really your session, and I'm grateful to all of you for being here today. So feel free to learn from his vast experience as a professional. And before I end, I want to just say a couple of words of NHRD and one more thing. What I learned from Shubhro is, have any of you heard of a behavioral economist called Daniel Kahneman? Any of you? Some of you have, okay? So Daniel Kahneman talks about a way of thinking. He calls it system one thinking and system two thinking, okay? System one thinking is reactive thinking, okay? So it's based on impulse, right? So something happens to you, you react and you take a decision, right? So somebody shouts at you, you shout back, for example, or somebody does something to you and you do something. You're not really spending the time. So I was a rookie manager when I first came to work with Shubhro, and I think what Shubhro taught me was really the ability to step back and think. And I don't know whether I've been able to do that very well, but I think that's what I have most learned, because ultimately, as you grow in life, a lot of more decisions that you take are very complex, and for everything that you do, whether it's the job you take up, or the person you choose to marry, or the place where you want to live, everything that you take decisions in your life has to be given due thought and deliberation, so that, well, you can still go wrong, but at least you made a choice, right, after thinking it through. And a lot of the way, what we call about maturity is just that, right? So being a professional is also about being mature, it's about having the courage, and it's also about the ability to learn, reinvent, and embrace change as it comes along, because the world will keep changing, right? So with that, thank you Shubhro for being here. And before I invite Shubhro to come on stage, I just want to spend a couple of minutes on National HR Network. So this is a program that, the leadership series that we keep running. This is a free program for everybody. And the whole idea is to bring you either a curated session of either a very eminent personality, or maybe a panel of very eminent personalities, talk about things that are not usually spoken about. There are a lot of stuff that you see in the press and read in the press, and there are a lot of fads, there are a lot of things, but actually in organizations, things work very differently from what gets reported in newspapers. And some of you young professionals may not know it, may know it, but I can only testify that having worked with an organization and working for 20 years now, what gets reported in the business press or in magazines is very different from what actually happens in organizations. So the question is, what is the right thing? Is what happens in organizations the right thing? Or is it what happens, what gets reported in newspapers, the right thing to be? So my point is that I'm not trying to advocate one for the other. All I'm saying is, for every narrative, there is a counter narrative, right? So why, to give a simple example here, the narrative that we're trying to build in NHRD, and it is founded in the early 80s by Dr. P.V. Rao and Uday Patil, that is going to be a learning and networking forum, right? For HR professionals. It's a community for all of us, and all of us can come together, learn from each other. And I think, just digressing a bit on this, you know, one of the things that often people say is that the loneliest job in the world, of course, that of the US president, but having said that, coming home to us, is a CEO's job. They say the CEO's job is very lonely because you're at the top of the summit. Who do you trust? Who do you talk to? I can tell you that if you're a good HR professional, invariably the CEO will talk to you. And Shubhro is one of those people who has been a trusted confidant to many CEOs, right? But I can also tell you that being a CHRO is as lonely, if not lonelier, than being a CEO, right? And that's when, whom do you talk to?
So that's why you need a network of friends and professionals. Not just from the fact that if it's a reference check that you want, nobody will owe you a good reference check if you don't have a relationship with them. Right? You can't expect them to tell you the real truth about a person. You haven't invested in building. So if you are an HR professional who spent time building those relationships, right? Not only will you have access to many nuances about people when you're hiring from them from different companies, you'll also have things like compensation data, which is not available through a compensation benchmarking survey. So my only point to all of you as young professionals is there's a lot of value you can get from forums like National HRD Network in terms of building relationships, nurturing relationships, which can hold you in good stead as a professional, as you go further in your career. But more importantly, you make a lot of friends and you learn a lot from each other, because it's in that learning that you do go forward. So while the counter narrative to this is that you should be focused on the organization and you should only work with the organization and be a good professional, and this is really may not be such a good use of your time, I can only say that in my life, it's proved to give me a lot more rich dividends than probably I would have realized 10 years back. So I just want to leave that thought with you, that do my sales pitch here to say that please do join NHRD and become a member, because we need all your support to build it for the community. And that's my appeal to all of you, that taste us and see. And if you want to contribute or volunteer in any way, do feel welcome. But more importantly, do support by becoming a member, because then we can curate more and more programs which can be learning events for all of you. Having said that, Shubhro, I will invite you and Shubhro, Amish, to come on stage. And thank you so much for being here and leaving the floor to both of you.
For the lovely introduction, for sharing your thoughts and the context setting for this session so beautifully. Thank you very much. It's indeed a great pleasure for me to host this session on behalf of the Mumbai chapter of NHRDN, but equally, even greater privilege to be sitting next to Shubhro Mitra. Thank you, Shubhro, for coming over. So, Shubhro, when I was thinking about this session, and I was really intrigued by this word, mastery, you know, and I really wanted to dig deep and figure this word out. So when I looked up the dictionary, I got two definitions for mastery. One is comprehensive knowledge or skill in a particular subject or something. Okay. Another definition which came about mastery was control or superiority over something or some subject. Okay. So that got me thinking. You know, skill and knowledge, right? Is that the mantra for business success? And somewhere I felt that what really counts, apart from an individual's skill and knowledge, is perspective. Okay, and how does one build perspective? And some of the ways in which people build perspective is through their experiences. And a lot of perspective about life, about the context, about the business in which you are in, is built by watching and listening to seasoned professionals, right? And then that's why we're all here, right? And another good friend of mine, Shubhro, said a lot of rich learning happens through conversations, right? So I will stop here and start the conversation. Yes, Shubhro? So there's one particular question which has been going through my mind after, you know, going through your profile and your career graph. Your career spans close to around about 32 years, and you would have encountered numerous and different business cycles, some say upswings and some downswings. So the question here is, do you believe HR practices are differentiators for business success or failures, or business results are more dependent on the vagaries of the economic environment, or maybe a strategy or a bet which turned out lucky or unlucky? So maybe you could use any of your examples or thing to share your initial views on this.
Thanks, Anuj. I'd like to thank Jeet actually for being very glowing words about me. So I'm very thankful, Jeet, but I'm just getting worried about being able to uphold all the things that you said. Coming back to Anuj's question, you know, Anuj just started with which is the most dangerous question, because I can talk for the next 2 hours. And that is exactly what I won't like to do it. So Anuj, I will try and break it down into a few things, because it's just so many things that we can talk about. But I would like to start with my personal experience where, you know, I didn't come from an HR background. Some of you are very privileged to start being educated in HR, MBAs, or in the starting has been a great, great HR area. So one of my challenges being to learn HR. Ajit said, I was lucky that I was in an organization which was very, had a great practice. And the second challenge was to really understand HR, not from what HR is all about, but from, I mean, it's a little jargon, but I would just say, is there a more practical way which makes sense? So, you know, the word HR is a little worry for me because it's a business, and those of you who started working, they say, you HR. The problem is there's nothing called HR. You know, it's in an organization which constitutes not robots but people, it's about people, it's not about HR. So I'll start with that because then when you start touching any subject, it's around HR or people. Now, whether you talk about a culture, whether you talk about skills of people, whether you talk about creating the right of getting on board the right people, you talk about anything, it is centered on people. And you can talk about business cycles, who creates those business cycles around people? Who gets them out? Why does some organization get out of business cycles better than the others? Because some of the people are doing the right things, because they have the right capabilities or they have the right values which they hold when the things are tough. So it's around various aspects. And personally for me, I've always seen that organizations which have succeeded have had the right people with the right values. They have sustained it because they have really applied this over time, but with skills of the people that they have recruited. So I would probably stop here, Anush, because the question is such a large question. You know, we can go into different aspects. I would like to stop here because I think we'll explore a few of these aspects through you or through some of the questions which might come through. But I've also thrown open a very big point so that we can pick up somewhere here or something else and we can dialogue. So I just want to say one more thing about dialogue. You know, one of the things I've said, because you picked up a lot of things which sort of resonated with me. If there is one medicine, you know, I don't think there are many old people here like me. There was a drug called Ceftron, which was by a company called Burroughs Wellcome. Now, at one point of time when the doctors had no clue, you know, what to give, they should give Ceftron, because it was called the wonder drug. It was a very, you know, broad-based drug, and it would hit anything. So this wonder drug, when someone says from my perspective, what is this wonder drug? In a people perspective, HR perspective, I would say, just have a dialogue. Unfortunately, in today's day and age, we don't have dialogues. We don't have authentic dialogues. And if you can have a dialogue, you understand people, and you can figure out what to do to overcome those things. So, I would leave it here, Anuj, because we talked about dialogue. I just wanted to say that it's an amazing drug, and whether it's NRD network or it's anything else, or at home, please have dialogues because that's one beautiful drug which you don't use enough.
It's great. I think so. Really like that part about being practical, and more often than not, people tend to kind of straitjacket or put HR as if we are HR and that is business. But Shubham, isn't that happening very early in a young professional's life, where during his MBA days or while in his second year, he has been asked to specialize? Then in the offer letters which most companies give out, they are saying you're going to be part of this department and this is your core identity and not the whole business. So for a lot of these young students and young professionals around, what would be your view and your perspective on how one should approach this? At one level, we can say we're all part of the business, but then there are different identities which are created early on in a young professional's life. So how would one want to go about that?
No, I guess you will have designations, you will have functions or whatever. That's not a problem. I think the real challenge is that when you enter an organization, what is the first thing you do? apart from understanding, and you talked about mastery, I think that's a very critical one. I would say there are two masteries to master. One is, of course, your own core skills in the function. If it's HR, if it's anything, finance, if you are able to master that, because that's where people will ask you about, and they will take advice. And as you get more senior, you become start becoming a more of an expert. So there is always an expectation to come and talk to you about certain things and take advice, or you're supposed to figure out certain things for the organization. So that I would not take away. But the second mastery is around understanding how the business works. Whether you are in manufacturing, whether you are in financial sector, whether you're in services, the key thing is that how does the business work? What is the business model? How do you make money for a business? What are the issues that you can face in the business? What are the triggers for making or losing in a business cycle? Now, once you're able to figure this out, then you apply your knowledge in your subject, it makes sense. And if you cannot do that, then you will come completely out of, I think, cold. So for people who are launching into the career or who have just launched it, my suggestion would be, you know, the first few years, don't concentrate on money, don't concentrate on anything else, concentrate on becoming a master in these two areas. Once you get a master, you know, whether you want money, you want whatever, it flows. So understanding how that works, and the second and the third thing is around how do you convert the business mastery knowledge into, you know, from our HR point of view or HR practices, and convert this to give a business solution. Because as I said, any business you are in, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50%, 100%, 80%, I don't know how much, is around people. And if it's around people, we all play a huge role. So I think, it's an amazing, and that is one reason that, to be very frank with you, in spite of being asked many a times, I didn't move out of HR because I just love the subject, I love the area, and I think what you can impact in HR, I don't think in any other function you can impact as much. So this is something which, I know there are some people who moved out of HR and, you know, he's smiling at me now, but I'm sure you'll get back to HR.
So very interesting. So. Go for your calling in terms of your specialization, build deep mastery over there, but you need to know your business as well, right? So that's something which is a useful takeaway for all of us here, Shubham. But there's another thing which is doing the rounds apart from the specialization. It is this thing about which industry should I pick up. FMCG is kind of getting slow, manufacturing is out, startup is in, financial services maybe paying me a bit more, so maybe, I don't know, where should I get in? Is industry, or where, which is going to be my first industry, is that something which is important? How do I get through this maze of choices that we have?
I must say this is a very personal choice. So if you're very attracted to money and that's the only focus, find the organization that gives you the biggest money. I don't know what will happen after that. But that's your choice. So if you ask me, my suggestion at this point of time, and though I've crossed the bridge long years back, I would say that the first is about choosing the right organization. You know, the right place, it could be in any sector. And you talked about a little bit of learning, and that's where I come from. I mean, where would you be able to learn the maximum? In terms of the business, in terms of the role, in terms of the content of the function, where do you learn most? Which organizations offer you the learning in terms of, because they are an organization which is open to that, provides opportunities, gives you the space. It's just not about learning, it gives you space to experiment, it gives you space to do things, gives you opportunities in the job. They are not a structured organization, which means that you can only do this for the next 10 years and then after 11 years you can think of something else. It experiments with you, and that these elements really, you know, in 2-3 years, and where you can get stretched in 2-5 years, you know, you will pick up phenomenal aspects, and then the world is open, especially for HR people. you can move from any sector to another sector, and I don't think there's any sector which, you know, it sort of says you cannot move from here to there. Especially HR, as I said, you know, this really gives us an opening. So once you get that grounding, once you get that solidity, right in the few years, after that, the world is open. So that's the way I would think of. But I guess you also need to look at your own, you know, passion, what excites you most, and then take a cool call on that one. But I would just say that be careful that it's not unidimensional, that it's money, or it's like, it sounds great, or it has some dazzle. I mean, unfortunately, you know, once you get into an organization, you realize it's all the same. So, but if you can choose on these parameters, it sort of provides the launchpad for the future.
Thank you, Shubhra. I think so. On behalf of you guys, I've asked a few questions. If there's any questions in the audience on this topic about what's the right career, what's the right specialization, what's the right industry, I think the Shubhra has spelled it out very nicely for us. Go where the learning is, go where the challenge is, and try it out, have an open mind, have a learning orientation, and if you're good, money and success will follow. So that's the takeaway that I have for Shubhra. Any questions at this point of time on career, on industry, or any career choices? Otherwise, we will move to next set of questions which I have for Shubhra. Anyone in the audience who wants to get into the conversation now? Yeah, could I have the mic over there?
I'm studying in MIS Institute, and I just wanted to ask about, there's a bus of specialists and generalist role for HR. So could you just brief, and what do you think about having a career, and which side can you go, and what is it?
Again, I would just say that you don't know what you don't know. So first of all, you have to figure out what are the roles. What are the kind of areas where there is what one could specialize in, or so I think it's more important to understand the specific roles first, what it entails. You could also look at from a point of view at this point of time you're studying. You could also look at what you genuinely be interested in. Now that's not an easy answer, easy question to answer, because you don't know what you don't know. So how do you know what you're going to be interested in? So I would suggest that in the initial stages, it could be a little bit of hit and run, you know. Just get into something, but I would again say look at an organization first, rather than the role specifically. Unless you have got a very clear passion about something. For example, in HR, if someone is very interested in analytics, and this is the today's buzzword, because the data analytics, and there is a lot of scope in HR which HR is not good at. So guys who are good in data, who are good in analytics, you have a very clear area in HR which you can get into, which is more the metric side, which could be on the compensation reward side. If you're interested with figures, numbers, and that attracts you. If you are really keen, if you think that you have a good knack for people, you can connect with people, you have insights about people, it could be on the recruitment side, attraction side. So those are simple things which you can probably fit a little bit. But beyond that, it is probably good to get into an organization which offers a space, offers opportunities, and then after a couple of years, it starts becoming more clear that how you can shape your career. Now, even in shaping a career, personally for me, I've never been in a specialist role. Yet, I have gone in depth into many areas of HR to qualify nearly a specialist. But yet I've become more of a generalist. And there are more people who have become more specialist, moved into, you know, generalist. So I would say there's nothing right and wrong about it. It's a question of what you prefer. And at the end, where you want to end up with. There are some people who would like to remain and be specialist and enjoy that. There are a lot of people who ask me that question, that if you're successful in HR, but you're not successful as a businessman, why don't you move to business? Because there is also a feeling that the only success is if you become a CEO of an organization. Okay? Now, that's your choice. You know, nobody says, I mean, you define your own success. you define what means success to you. You know, and that's probably a question I'll go back to the audience. What does success mean to you? And if I ask 100 people sitting out here, I'm 100% sure it'll be 99 or 100 different answers. Okay. So there is never a set answer. You define what means to you, what is success, and define a path which you would like to take. And never be embarrassed or ashamed that I didn't become that. No, it's your choice and your capabilities, and you know, just go and do that.
Any more? Otherwise, I'll move to our next area of subject, which is very interesting personally for me. It's around the work which we do in HR and culture. So, yeah, move ahead. Great. So, Shubha, this is an interesting one which I came across. It goes something like this. And I think, so if I'm not mistaken, it was Peter Drucker who had mentioned this. Culture eats strategy for breakfast. Okay. So first, would you agree with this kind of a statement, or would you disagree with it? And then you say, how do you build a good cultural family around the organization, which can support the business objectives or business results which that particular enterprise is driving for? What comes first?
I'm going to stand up a bit, because I think you're getting a little tired. So I would check, and maybe I can just hear, you don't have to use the mic. What does culture mean? What is culture? You don't have to be a perfect definition. It can be one word, it can be three words. Just wanted to hear from different corners of the room, what is culture for you?
Individuality.
Sorry?
Individuality.
Individuality.
A group of people having the same concept in terms of working.
So the second one, if you've not heard, a group of people working together.
Having the same mindset.
Having the same mindset. Okay.
Following the same values.
A way of working.
Loving your workplace.
Loving your workplace. See, this is the beauty. You ask a definition, and you have a very copybook definition. You have a very personal definition. There's everything right, and that's the difficulty of culture. Okay. There is nothing. I mean, of course, there are great people who have written a lot of great books about and talks about culture, but in my personal opinion, there's nothing which defines, you know, one word, one sentence which can capture this. It's a big word. So I would just start with, it's difficult to understand and grasp what is culture. So if I have to be very simple in my own words, I would just say, when you walk into, let's say, a restaurant and you smell something, and it's beautiful smell, you just love it. You just know that this is the place. And on the contrary, you walk into a restaurant where the smell doesn't really, it doesn't really appeal. You know you need to walk out. In my opinion, culture is like that. You can smell it. You walk into a place, you see the people, you see their faces, you see how they're interacting with each other. So you know that you know the authentication. And believe you me, all of us know that. Right? We are perceptive people, we can walk in and we can immediately see how it's operating. We can see in some organizations, people are talking, they are quite, quite dynamic, they are quite interactive. You can see the friendliness, you can see a smile, you can see that there is energy. And you walk into some other place, you see completely reverse. So, Anuj, I come back to whether it's each strategy for breakfast or for lunch, I'm not too sure. But I would probably say that, if you don't have the right ingredients, and someone said values, everything is part of that. If you don't have the right ingredients, to have a sustainable performance in an organization is not easy. And hence, it's very important that you set a culture which defines the way we work, how we work, and how we go through that whole process. And it was very interesting, someone asked me that question and it really resonated. They said that, is culture something that you set up and you don't change? Or is something that you need to change? But we always hear about the fact that you set a culture, the why you talk about change. Now, it was very fascinating, and it was in the context, Anuj, I think you mentioned about this, is, and you talked about VUCA, Kaljeet mentioned about VUCA. Now, in a changing environment, you know, and I'll give you an example. In a changing environment, and you say, and this is the old days, we used to say we set a culture. Then the culture of that organization is this. Now, when you talk about in a fast-changing VUCA environment, and he explained what is VUCA, these are jargons that we use, and our consultants use quite a bit because they have to make money. They invent it. Every 6 months they invent a different one. And we fall track to that, and be very careful, please don't fall, because the business managers don't understand this language. Okay, so we talk, and HR people talk a different language to the other people, and they don't understand us. So just be careful. So whatever this, in the fast-changing environment, which you call VUCA, if you have a culture which is, I would say, which is flexible, and the culture is around flexibility, culture is about learning, culture is about openness, culture is about adaptability. If you have that is a culture. You know, that is the one which is not, it is set in stone in a way, but it is set in stone to be a flexibility, to bring openness. So you can manage in this changing world if you set a culture, which is that. But if you set a culture that, you know, we talked about the organization, we both work together. You know, at one point of time, you won't believe it, we were changing the whole organization structure every 12 to 18 months. And it was like crazy. I worked in a very steady state organization, and I could come to terms with that. But that was spelling success for the organization at that stage, because we had to be very dynamic. And the way we are moving people every 18 months, it was, from an HR point of view, it was like, I cannot tell you the amount of work we had to do. But that defined the success of it, and I learned a lot from there. And this was really initiated by our CEO at that stage. So it's about that. And the whole culture was set around dynamism in terms of change, in terms of really, you know, pushing people to the limits. So I would just say, Anuj, back to your question, that yeah, you can set a beautiful strategy, but to deliver the strategy in a consistent, sustained basis, we need to have these kind of cultures which would help us to do that. And if we didn't have that, you can set the best strategy, it cannot get executed.
Super, very, very interesting. But there's a practitioner's dilemma which was brought to me. They're saying that I represent this company which really believes in collaboration, and that's a culture that ethos which they very strongly value. But as an HR process, you guys have the normal distribution curve, where I'm pitted against my peers and I'm competing with them for the same rating. So while there is an espoused culture, which is shown in your presentation, it's there on the board and it's splashed across along with the vision statement, but there is also an HR practice where I'm supposed to be competing with my peers. So is it consistent? Have you changed? Or is it in a separate context, and this is in a separate context? So this HR colleague of mine didn't have a very good way of answering it back. So how would you pick this question up, and what would be your views on this?
I mean, I don't know whether you've been reading a lot on performance management, but in today's world, there's lots and lots of it spoken. You know, in some of the organizations, they're talking about removing the performance appraisal process completely. What was interesting when I was reading it and I was going through those organizations, spoke to a couple of them, they actually haven't removed it. You know, it's still there. The ratings are still there, but it's done in a different way. Anyway, that's a different point. So sometimes, you do that, you know, in funny ways. But I don't know whether it's publicity award. So I think Jeet mentioned about that, what's written in the press, what is happening, just be careful. Because things are reported in a different way, done in a different way. Having said that, there are different organizations which do not have a performance appraisal at all. I mean, if you really look at some of these startups, you look at some of the organizations in Silicon Valley, and where we spent a lot of time thinking and studying what they were doing, they didn't have that. You know, they had a very different way of doing things. Now, the question I ask is, that's fine in 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, but what happens after 10 years? So let's talk about Google. So Google has amazing recruitment, but don't they have a performance? They have a performance. They have a performance rating. Now, whether you do a curve or bell curve or Z curve, I don't know, but at the end of the day, you want to reward people. You want to make sure, you want to make sure that they have objectives to follow or focus on. You want to reward them based on how they perform. Now, it's up to us as an organization. What do we want to reward? Okay. So if you want to reward collaboration, now here comes, Anuj, the question that if a person is performing well on the numbers or the what part in terms of the objectives, you can actually have an equally strong how part. How does he or she go about doing it? Now, if he or she is doing a great job in delivering numbers, but is not at all collaborating. Actually, Geet asked me to share some personal examples. So let me share at this stage a very personal example. There was a CEO in AXA who was, in my opinion, one of the best CEOs in terms of mind, in terms of creativity, in terms of customer focus, in terms of delivery, in terms of making sure what the company was performing. So when I look at every parameter of performance, this person was one of the best. The issue was in terms of behaviors, okay? In terms of how he behaved with the regional team and people in terms of collaboration. He felt, I'm the god, don't touch me. So there was no collaboration, you couldn't talk to him, and so on and so forth. So from a behavior point of view, he or she, and also with some of the people, how he would speak in terms of language, what language he would pick up. And a lot of people actually was pointing out the finger that we talk about behaviors, we talk about values, but what do we value most? And one thing I've heard people say that I don't hear what you say, I hear what I see. Yeah, you get that? So you can say that we believe in this, but I see that this guy is still there. He's still prospering. So I'm not seeing that this you have done anything to this person. And when I don't see that, how do I believe you? Because you're seeing the right things. Again, you talked about a little bit of courage. It took me a long time, I would say 3 years. And finally, this year, we actually exited him. In a small way that was, I should use the word, but if I use that word, it was a little victory. Not my victory, but the victory that we have set up, that behaviors are important. Yeah? So I would just say that you can put the values, you can put all the things that, but it's very important what you do with it. And once you do that, it is very clear now that we will not tolerate that behavior. It took a long time, I must say. And it happens because you have a CEO change, you have some other change, and everybody says, but I want to see him a little bit more, but I find him, his figures are nice, he's done very well, what's wrong, let me get a chance. So it prolonged the time of that person, but as HR people, if you believe what you're doing is right, you're dogged about it, it will happen. You need patience. But coming back to Anuj's point, everybody has, I think we have these levers in performance. How we use the levers and how we demonstrate what we say we do creates the culture. Okay? So it's very important to make it happen. If you don't, I'm sorry, people don't believe it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thanks, Roshan. I think that helps because I think so at the end of the day, your systems and processes are as good as the people who are managing it. And if the leadership team does not demonstrate what they are showing as cultural values, and also it's not seen in the HR processes and system, then it's just something which is hanging in the wall, but not something which is practiced.
So that's a good.
Since you're talking about hanging the wall, I don't have the prop today, but there was this. It's not a joke. It's a serious thing. So in the US, they did a little bit of an experiment where they took very senior executives around the room. And around the room, there were beautiful values put up. Okay, I don't know if you've heard of this story, and it's a real story. They put up all the values and they said, can you go around the rooms and tell us which set of values attract you most? And most of the people had put up a tick in one of the values. Can you guess which organization's value was there? Just guess, you know, I know it's wild because I'm not giving the values. Just guess. Most of the people had ticked G. I mean, you know, we talk about G values. Any other guesses? Sorry?
Apple?
Any other guesses?
Facebook?
GE?
Enron?
I don't know if you remember the Enron. It was Enron. Okay? Now, the values were fantastically written. But the application or, you know, demonstration of that was poor. So you can have beautiful values, you can have what you say, but if you don't apply it, if you don't put it on ground, it's useless. So I think it's very important for us to make sure that wherever we are working or will work, we believe in those and we actually apply, we actually make it happen. And that's a critical one.
Thank you, Shubhra. I think it's a very nicely put. So it's all about in the demonstration. I've just one more thing on culture, and I think so it's been hanging around in the websites and it's there in the business magazines, and a lot of us end up reading it and believing it. And this is on these employment engagement surveys. And the other thing which we all get to know about a culture of a company is through maybe a company's participation in some of these best employer surveys and competitions which a lot of these consulting firms bring about. So is that the true source of knowing the right kind of a culture of a company, or is that the way in which we can know for sure that the employees are really committed and they are putting their discretionary effort in for the success of themselves and for the company? Or is there some other ways on which we get to know this right? And if you could share your views and experiences through the various companies that you work for, what's your take about this space?
I guess every company does their own culture service. And it has its own, I think, benefits. And I won't say that it's useless. It does definitely give perspectives and one can act or do something around that. You talked about, so these are two different things. You talked about best employer. So let me take it away for a while and let's deal with this. But if a company is seriously, keen on really looking at the employees and they want to really see how the employees feel, I think personally, if I go around the room and I ask you, what is that one thing which if you have in an organization, you love it, there will be very many different answers. Which means that if you treat people or employees as a bunch of people, a group of people, or is one thing, then treating very individualistic. It's not easy, but it's doable if you do it in small groups. Which means that every individual has a right to have a dialogue, to express his or her interest, passion. And if an organization is, and it's very simple, there are a couple of things, and tell me if I'm wrong. If you're working in an organization and the purpose of your work and your personal purpose is aligned, how easy or how difficult will it be? So if you are aligned with your personal goals and purpose with the organization's or your objectives, that's one. Second, if you are respected, you're listened, you're involved, that's true. Yeah. And what you do, if you have a say in that, and if you are having a regular dialogue, speak. So there are three or four simple things that we could do with each employee, and I would be very surprised if they are not going to be engaged. Now, do we do that? And there are many people who are managers here, I would say that the simple answer I get from most people is, we don't have time. But we have time. I mean, I must say that, I don't know how many of you are for manufacturing, but if I use a manufacturing term, it's called rework. Okay, if you don't get it first time right, rework is time consuming, is very expensive. So if you're going to not have that dialogue and have all these surveys, you know, how much time are you spend? Because then you have the surveys, then you have a small group discussion, then you have FGD, then you will assimilate, you will analyze, you will make action plans. My God, it takes time. And at the end of the day, I don't know it impacts as much as we can have those small group dialogues. So it's a very simple technique, doable, but are we passionate to it is the question. But if you do that, it's a win-win. But I'm saying these big things. Can I make it happen in my organization? No, it's not been easy for me. But can I make it happen in my group? Yes, it can happen.
And your views on the best employer, what's your take? How much do we take it very seriously? Is it believable? What's your take? Because there are different.
I'll probably be a little cynical here. And I think Jeet talked about courage. You know, one thing you can test me is ask a question, I'll always have an answer. And I will not lie to you. So my take on this is that be careful. Many organizations I've encountered, it's fraud. I'm using a very strong word. It's what's it for me? You know, so there are people who run this, and the organizations who win are people who win because he or she is giving some benefits to that person. So on an average, I didn't find this at all useful. Unfortunately, these are used in the press for publicity, and we fall for the trap. So that is one. Having said so, there are probably a couple of organizations who are trying to run it. I'm still not fully convinced, because sometimes they don't even understand. They have a very series of things, and if you're very smart, you can actually, you know, play around with that. But you know, it does have some truth in it, and there are a couple of people probably doing it well. But on an average, there are so many organizations who do that, and when you look at, you know, you look at something, you'll find that this organization wants this, that organization wants this, but many of them I found has not been, you know, it's not done authentically. So I didn't believe in that, to be very frank. I participated, I must say. I've gone through that, and I did feel, because in a couple of things, it was very clear what was there, but I'm sure some of the studies is not so badly rigged or so badly done. But the problem I face is that these are all picked up in the press, and you know, people, it will get sucked up. So we all play the game together. So,
thank you, Shubha, for that perspective. And I also think something which really resonated with me was this, that every individual manager or a leader has his sphere of influence when it came to the response about employee engagement. And one can make a difference within his own circle of influence or the locus of control. And obviously, the here and now work comes in, and because of which there is rework. But if you are reaching out and aligning purposes, getting the alignment and commitment with your objective, with your team's objective, I think so the going will become much smoother, and then you will get the discretionary effort which you want from the team. I think that was really lucky, Shubha. At this point of time, I would like to open this part of the section open for the audience to join in the conversation. Anyone who wants to have a question for Shubha on culture, on performance, on employee engagement, do bring in that question now. And I'm looking around for seeing if there are any hands coming up. There's one here.
Usually when we speak about culture and VSAT surveys and all, it sounds comes very easily. And like you described it beautifully, just in 3 pointers, it is really beautiful. But while implementing, we always have a survey, which every employee has to fill up, and then we take a rating and bell curve and all that stuff. So can we really implement this it very simply with just 3 pointers in a group discussion, I don't know, with manager, without manager, so as to avoid the bias? But can it be made so simple that it can be actually thought upon in a practical way, as to it will give us a real indication and an indication to move forward from where to?
I think it can be. The challenge would be in a large organization because there's numbers involved. But you can always try in a small group. And I would say the implications are very simple. So in a small group, if you try it, and not only try, I mean, it's not about hearing, but it's also actioning it. Once you action it and you find that two things happen. The first thing is people stay. So they stay. Number two, which happens, is not only they stay, but they, and this is something I can't probably show it in a kind of a numbers, but you walk into that department, you will find that the energy, the connection, and the smile is much greater than anyone else. It is visible. Yeah? And the third thing is you will find that they are a very different bunch of people than the other organizations when it comes to, you know, the delivery in terms of working in an organization. It's a completely different experience that group brings. So I think it's doable. However, having said so, it, in my opinion, it needs to spread, you know, from one to three departments. I've tried in the past. I continue doing that. So the real challenge, I would say, is also the second thing is that, I mean, it's not always easy. You know, it sounds very easy. To ask it's easy, but to deliver is not always easy. So you also need managers and people, and not just different HR, who can take this easy concept, believe in it, and run it. You know? And forget about the fact, because this is an excuse which keeps coming, I don't have time. But as I keep saying that they don't have time for this dialogue, but they waste a lot more time trying to fix many other things. So I hope we can just explain to the people. If you ask me, have I seen it happen anywhere else in a large, big measure? No. They're still falling in trap of these, you know, employee surveys and all that. That's an easy trap because, you know, it's easy. You just send it to everyone, it gets it, you do an analysis, you come back, you give a beautiful thing, you do an action plan, and next year it happens. And we are a zombie, we keep doing that.
Hi,
Shubhra,
I'm
Shalini.
My question is related to how culture is just exists. So for example, to my mind, culture is between a set of people, a group of people. And as you rightly said, it shows on the faces. But in an organization, you know, when you go from one branch to the other, or you go from one corporate office to the other, you can find that there is a shift in culture. And it happens. So in who takes the responsibility? Is it like culture is top driven? Or, you know, somebody needs to, you spoke just now about the managers, you know, taking the responsibility, and sometimes they don't have time, that's what they say. So what really happens is when they don't have time, there still is a culture. So culture always exists. And if in an organization you have to have a uniformity, then how do we bring that?
It's a good question, actually. I mean, to bring enough uniformity, there is, I would say it starts with the top, and it starts with top down. And it's also very critical that when you see the top, and let's say in an organization of 10,000 people, and you're looking at the top 10 people, do they all exhibit the same thing? And it's cascading. Do the next 20 people or 30 people do and say the same thing? And do the next, and do the next. So in a way, it is complex, but in a way, it's simple, because it's cascading, that's one. However, in a large organization, it's very important that there are some systems and processes which supports that. You know, I just explained to you about my experience. Now, we talked about behavior, but we didn't demonstrate the behavior even from a CEO. And when you don't do that, Nobody believes in that, and nobody will follow that. So if you are sort of saying that I'm going to, the promotions are based on merit, is based on your performance, and it's based on your behaviors, but your promotions are all based on everything else but behaviors, what is the culture that you study? It's okay to misbehave and be promoted. Okay. So what I'm saying is that it is, I mean, it's a simple thing again, it's walking the talk. And what is the consequence of not walking the talk? Okay. If you do not have a system or process which, you know, which eliminates those elements, it will not cascade. But when you do that, you know, it does cascade, number one. Number two, which has been my experience, I mean, people are interesting, you know. I mean, once they know that there's a consequence, and if they're defined, most of them fall in line. Okay, when I say fall in line, not as in a regiment, but okay, because that's, they know that what is the boundaries for them. So it's very important to actually share the consequence. And hence, in people, in every function, senior, junior, middle, you need that courage to face up to you and say the consequence. And most managers do not have the courage. Okay? Because it's not easy. So those are issues that organizations face. That if you do not say the consequence, it don't happen. And if you don't have the courage, it doesn't happen. So you have to have those, and you know, someone mentioned about GE. I mean, you know, every organization has got its bads and goods, but GE is one organization which has been very strong on that point. And if you really look at people, now you can disagree with me, I mean, there are people who just fall in line completely, but at least in that organization, the whole thing breaks down. Sometimes too strongly, and I mean, again, if you're not doing it well, then there is misuse of that also, which is also not good. So there are, I mean, these balances does, misbalances does happen. But on an average, you're very clear, you know, you show the consequence, you act on the consequence, and I think people then start doing the same thing. Right? Otherwise, it will be very individualistic driven. So in one branch, as you said, if you have a manager who believes in that, does that, it's a very different branch. And the other one is completely different because that person is not cascading all the things that he or she was supposed to do.